Hello everyone, how are you doing today? Welcome to my channel, and today we are going to talk about Apache Kafka, and we are going to look into what are Kafka brokers, topics, partitions, storage and replication. And the best thing is that I am going to explain all those things in a non-programming way using some pictures. So whosoever you are, you should be able to understand what is Apache Kafka and how it works in this video. Now, why I am talking about Apache Kafka? So guys, you know, if you are using some social media like LinkedIn or Slack or even a streaming platform like Netflix, it is highly likely that at some places in their tech stack ecosystem, they are using Apache Kafka to make sure that they deliver the service to you because of which you have subscribed to their platform. And that's why Apache Kafka is extremely important. You may end up using it, you may not end up using it, but it doesn't hurt to know about it. So what is Apache Kafka? Apache Kafka is an open source distributed event streaming platform. Now, I know you all know the meaning of open source and distributed. What is this event streaming platform? You know, have you ever wondered how all these social media, you know, apps track us? How they come to know that what we want, what we are watching, what, you know, pages we looked into, where we clicked, how they know all those things? All those things are nothing but events, and they need these events to be able to, you know, serve us better, to have the database which can allow them to serve us better. So events are something, you know, anything that happened, you know, we are, you know, experiencing events all the time. Something like if I switch on the fan of this room or start recording, stop recording, all these things are events. So what you do in Apache Kafka is that you store events, which is important to you. So that's why it's an event streaming platform. And you know, Apache Kafka is fast also, where you can, you know, stream data as events in near real time. Okay. For example, if you are driving a car, you need to stop your car when there is a red light. You need to start your car when there is an orange light. You need to actually move when there is a green light. What are these things? Red, orange, green, these are events. Red light happened, event. Orange light, event. Green light, event. And you have to take an action on that. So Apache Kafka helps you to, you know, respond to events in real time, right? Near real time. There is nothing known as, you know, pure real time. And the definition of near real time actually depends upon your, you know, scenario. Okay. Now, if you want to use Apache Kafka, how can you make use of it? Well, there is a concept in Kafka called topics. Topics are central concept in Kafka. So if you want to categorize things in one particular place, one type of event in one particular place, you put that in a topic. Okay. It's very similar to, you know, the way you categorize your room. You put books in bookshelf and you put your clothes in cupboard. You sit in your chair. You work on your desk table. So all those things happens in different part of your room. Okay. And that's the abstraction of topics. So let's assume that you are creating an app where you are tracking, you know, user activity. So user visiting which website, you can have one topic for that. How much time user spends in a website or in a YouTube video, you can have a topic for that. How many times user, you know, works based on your recommendation, you can have a topic for that. How many times user works based on his or her friend's recommendation, you can have a topic on that. And it's totally up to you how many topics you create. So you interact with Apache Kafka, whether you are someone who is putting data in Apache Kafka or someone taking data from Apache Kafka. Both producers and consumers interact with Apache Kafka topics. Now, each and every topic is divided into partitions. Okay. So the meaning of partition is very similar to, you know, the way we partition our books in our, you know, bookshelf. So one partition will have one set of data of your topic. Another partition will have another set of data. So partition will not contain duplicated data. So if you are putting a number 1 to 10, it is likely that, you know, odd numbers comes in one partition, even number comes in another partition, and so on and so forth. Okay. So whenever you put a data into a topic. Okay, you store data in a particular partition because topic is an abstraction. Partition is the place where all the data is stored actually. And even when you are taking data from a topic, you are taking data from a partition. Okay, and all the partitions are, you know, arranged into segments. And segments are the way Kafka actually stores the data in a partition, but it's something you don't need to worry about much at this moment of time. But it is the partition that you need to worry about. Partitions are the key for everything in Apache Kafka, including, you know, how your consumers will behave, how your producers will behave, and how the replication factor will work up, and, you know, how the storage will be done. So we are going to look into partitions. Now, whenever one or more client produces data for a particular topic, okay, they interact with topic, they don't directly interact with partition, though there are ways to make sure that a particular set of data goes to a particular partition. That is possible, but you interact with topic first. Without topic, you cannot reach into partition. You put data into your topic. Now, once one or more producers put data into a topic, Kafka internally, you know, stores that particular data in multiple partitions. When you create a topic, by default, it is only having one partition, but we can define a partition that how many number of partitions we want. So in this particular case, in this particular picture, I have, you know, shown you three partitions. So I can create three partitions for a topic, and it's up to me. I can create 3, 4, 5, 10 partitions of a topic. And, you know, I can actually increase the number of partition in runtime, but I cannot decrease that. Again, that's an advanced topic about which we will see at some later point of time. Just consider whatever data you are putting in your topic. The orange data goes to partition 1, the green data goes to partition 2, and all the other mixed color data goes to partition 3 in this scheme of things which you are seeing in your screen right now. Now, once I put data into partition, data is there in topic, and the data is supposed to live there maybe forever, but by default it is 168 hours or 1 week, or, you know, 10 GB of data if I remember it correctly. There is some configuration you can change while starting your Kafka to state that how long you want things to be there. So if you define a GB of data, for example 10 GB, it will not hold more than 10 GB, or it will not hold data more than 7 days old. All those things you can change. So with Apache Kafka, in this context, it is different from other message queue system like RabbitMQ, where any consumer comes and takes the data and the data is, you know, lost from the queue most of the time. So this is how things are arranged. And if the producers are keep on producing, the partitions will keep on growing. Data will not be deleted until and unless it reaches its, you know, expiry criteria. To read those data, we need consumers. Now, just like producers, we can have multiple consumers. And let's assume that we created three consumers for this particular topic. What will happen in this particular case is that all three consumers are standalone consumers. They don't know about other consumers. And all the data from all the partitions will reach all consumers. Okay, so consumer 1 will get data from all three partitions, so does consumer 2 and consumer 3. Now, you must note one thing over here. The data, since it is in different partitions, it is not going to come to consumer in the sequence it was inserted. It is possible to get data in sequence from one partition, but it is not possible to get data in sequence from multiple partitions. It may be possible that you inserted 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and all those things are distributed across multiple partitions, and it is possible that your consumer will read 1, 3, 2, 9, 5, something like that. So if you want to keep things in sequence, you need to come up with some different arrangement, but in this scheme of things, you cannot read in sequence. It is not guaranteed. Now, more than one consumer can attach to, you know, one topic, and if a consumer is standalone, all the partitions will be attached to that consumer and all consumers will get that data. Now, this is a normal case. Again, when the consumers are getting the data is not deleted. from the partitions of the topic. Okay, how to delete, how the offset manages, we are going to see that in some other video, because that will make things complicated. Now, this scheme of things may not be suitable where, you know, you want to make sure that all consumers get different data from this particular topic, because you want to scale something and you want that some part of that work is done by one consumer, other part of work is done by another consumer. So how can we do that? We can do that in Kafka by combining consumers in a group. So in this particular picture, which you are seeing right now, all three consumers are part of one group called G1. They are part of a group. So what happens that when you create consumers out of a group, each consumer associates itself with a particular partition. So in here, I have three partitions and three consumers. So all consumers will associate itself with one partition. What will happen if there are only two consumers? One consumer will associate itself with one partition. The other consumer will associate itself with rest of the two partitions. What will happen if we have more consumers? No, you cannot have more consumers than partitions. Otherwise, the consumer will be sitting idle. The fourth consumer, if it is there, it will be sitting idle. So in this particular case, what happens that since each and every consumer is associated with one partition, they will get unique data. So whatever data is produced by multiple producers, it will be consumed by a consumer group, not consumer, a consumer group, which will have more than one consumers, and each consumer will get unique data. This is extremely helpful if you want to scale things, right? But what if you want to make sure that you can create another consumer which can also read data from the partitions from which this particular consumer in group G1 has already read? Well, you can do that. You can create another set of consumers in a different consumer group. In this particular case, group G2. So what happens that both consumers in group 1 and group 2 will get all the data. Okay, so this is again very useful in scaling. For example, let's assume that you are using consumer group 1 to, you know, service your customer, and you are using consumer group 2 to, you know, log all the logs in the database, right? So these things can run in an independent way, and it is very much possible to have multiple consumer groups. Okay, I hope this is clear till now. Now let's talk about storage and replication. While creating a topic, we can define the partitions. Yes, we talked about that, but we can also define replication factor. Replication factor means how many copies of partitions we want in multiple nodes of Kafka, which are called Kafka brokers. Okay, so all node, independent nodes, are called Kafka brokers, and they can reside anywhere in any data center or distributed data centers. Okay, the replication factor of 2 means all partitions will have a replica in a different broker or node at any point of time. So in this particular picture, you can see that partition 2 is having a replica in broker 1 and broker 3. Partition 3 is having replica in broker 1 and 2. Partition 1 is having replica in broker 2 and 3. And if you would increase the replication factor to 3, of course, all partitions will be there in all the brokers. Of course, you cannot increase the replication factor beyond 3 if you have only 3 nodes. That's why if you are using Apache Kafka in your local machine, you cannot, you know, increase the replication factor beyond 1, because there is no other node at this moment of time in the Apache Kafka cluster, which means that more than one node is arranged in Apache Kafka cluster. Now, since anyway we are talking about multiple nodes and clusters, you must know that if you have more than one node, it will form a cluster, and this cluster will be maintained by something called Apache Zookeeper. There is a plan to replace Apache Zookeeper with Kraft, but Zookeeper at this moment of time, for 3.x at least, the version 3.x at least, will be able to manage the cluster. Cluster management happens with Apache Zookeeper, which manages, you know, different nodes or different brokers, and takes care of leaders selection and many other things which is required to manage a cluster. So that's all about the basic introduction of Apache Kafka. I do hope and believe that I was able to explain things in the easiest possible way. Thank you all. Thanks for watching. We will definitely meet again. Until the next time we meet, good day, goodbye. You take care.